So let's contextualize the banking sector in Namibia, because you've got Standard Bank, Nedbank, FNB operations as well. There's Bank of Windhoek as well. Give us an indication of what investors can actually get exposure to from a share perspective.
Okay. First of all, you can get exposure to FNB Namibia specific, as it's a local company listed on our local board. And then you also have, we have also FirstRand listed on the NSX, on the main board, Nedbank or Netcore, if you want to state it like that, and Standard Bank Group. And that's all due listed on the JSE as well. So it's basically the same share. Bank Windhoek is also another bank operating in Namibia. However, they are not publicly listed or available to private investors.
So let's delve into some of the interesting numbers that are obviously going to affect the banking sector. Private sector credit extension, if you look at it relative to what we see in the retail space and consumer space and the corporate space, a massive decline is what we're seeing from a corporate perspective. Consumers are in a slightly better position. Why are we seeing such a massive decline? Resident private sector easing to around 9.8% on the credit growth front.
Yes. Okay, so as you've mentioned, the slowdown in private sector credit extension to 9.8% was mainly a result of the corporate sector borrowing a bit less. In fact, the credit extension by the corporate to the corporate sector actually slowed to approximately 5% year on year. That was mainly a result of corporates decreasing their overdraft facilities, and you saw a year on year decline of about 20% in overdrafts. And I think that's actually a good indicator, showing that corporates are well off, that they are healthy, that their balance sheets are quite healthy, and I think they are making use of the excess or the free cash flow that they have. Moving to the individuals, strong growth that we see there. I think growth of above to 12%, led by mortgage advances growth, and then particularly instalment sales that reported above 20% growth in instalment sales. And that was also evident in the motor of new vehicle sales that came out strongly the past couple of months.
Let's just touch on the interest rate environment going forward in Namibia. And as you mentioned, we actually saw great credit growth from an individual perspective. So it seems that the consumer is very much in a very advantageous position relative to what we see perhaps on the corporate front. Is the cost of capital looking attractive for the rest of the year?
Yes, okay, maybe from an interest rate view, I think we will follow South Africa closely, as we don't want to create some liquidity issues when our interest rates are too or much higher than South Africa's. I don't think there's further scope for downward interest rate cut, because the marginal benefit of interest rate cuts has been sort of exploited, and they will not, the kick that you will get from the consumer from another interest rate cut is quite minimal. From an interest rate hike perspective, as I've said, we will follow South Africa closely. And if you look to at South Africa, the slow momentum from South African GDP, and then also cost push inflation in that environment, not likely to push up interest rates this year.
Rume, what's also fascinating when it comes to Namibia and the lending practices there, you're far more conservative than what we see here in South Africa, and we're already considered quite conservative. Looking at the National Credit Act that was put into place in 2007, could you give us an indication of the differences from what we see here in South Africa and relative to what we actually experience in Namibia?
Okay. First of all, I think Namibia is relatively more conservative, although they are managed by the same companies. If you look at, say, gearing, for example, Namibia has below 10% gearing, that's debt to equity, where in South Africa it will range from above 10 to, say, close to 15 times. Another thing is also non-performing loans. That has come down quite significantly in Namibia. And you could see non-performing loans at between 1 and 2% compared to, say, 6, 7% in South Africa. So again, an indicator of a very conservative management. Same with impairments. Actually, FNB Namibia realizing impairment reversals, so it's an income to the or a surplus to the income statement, and just also again reflecting conservative management and conservative lending policies.
I'd like to look at the debt scenario that is playing out for the government of Namibia, because since 2009 we've actually seen an increase in debt accumulation. What's interesting to note is that on the shorter end of the curve we actually see far more demand and far more issuance than what we see at the longer end of the curve. This is an inverse trend from what we saw say in 2010. Why is this occurring?
Okay, first of all, I think the increase in short-term debt or debt less than 12 months maturity is due to two things. Firstly, Then the GC12 bond that is maturing in October, I think that's about 1.8 billion that will need to be repaid, that came into the short-term spectrum of the market. And then another thing, I think the government is focused on issuing short-term debt, as they've recently issued the euro bond, 500 million euro bond, which have a 10-year maturity. So in order to align their duration, to balance their duration from their perspective, they will be active in the short-term market. And I think from an investor perspective, they don't want to fix, they will want to take advantage of the short, the, or they don't want to fix their rates now with the low interest rate environment that we are in currently.
Yeah. Okay, so let's look at FNB.
So therefore the demand.
Let's look at FNB as an example of what we see coming through. Valuations looking quite attractive, 7.6 times. And we saw a cost-to-income ratio, which looks really good relative to what we see here. It's sitting at around 45%, just below that. Non-performing loan ratio, you alluded to this earlier, sitting at 1.3%. Some would argue the best level for a non-performing loan ratio is below 1%. What kind of trends are you expecting into 2012 for this company specifically?
Okay, I think, first of all, companies are very focused on cost at the moment, if you consider the global economic environment that we are in. And then I also think that the part of that increase in earnings that we've witnessed over the past 6 months, or say 18 months or so, was due to non-interest revenue growing quite strongly. And I think we can maybe expect that trend to continue if you consider the strong government budget that they've released last year, with focus on creating 100,000 jobs in Namibia. And if you have more jobs, you will see more accounts being opened, more transactions taking place, and therefore increased non-interest revenue. Interest revenue is a bit under pressure due to a margin squeeze with the prime rate the gap between the prime rate and the repo rate narrowing. However, there's still sufficient demand from an advances perspective. Basically, we can expect.
Very quickly, I just want to talk about the rumors that we saw last year with perhaps APSA being interested to enter the Namibian market. Very quickly, it's a very conservative market. Give us your sense about prospects going forward.
Okay, I think last year, end of last year, the Bank of Namibia actually issued a white policy paper on the ownership of banks, and they want to limit, or the intent is to limit foreign ownership in Namibian banks to 53%. Currently, FNB is surpassing that that range a bit. Both Nedbank and Standard Bank Namibia is fully owned by the groups in South Africa. So I think there is limited interest, or they will limit other foreign interest to Namibia. Yeah. Say for example, APSA wanting to take out Bank Windhoek, and I don't think that will necessarily be able from a regulation perspective.
Fantastic.